I don't know if it's what I'm teaching on today, that the enemy is just so prevalent. In this series called Counterculture, and as it says, it's not enough to focus on the comfortable issues, that we have to begin to address the issues that many churches, especially a new church, will begin to talk about. You know, a seminary, they tell you, there's certain things you don't do when you start a church. You don't talk about money, and you don't talk about social stuff right off the back. So we're breaking all the rules. Last week, Pastor Miranda did an amazing job about flipping tables in. She was just really setting the stage about what God has called not only one church to do, but he's called you to do it as well. And so today, if I had to title my lesson, the title would be The Bucks Stop Here, Generational Curses. And so when I think about what God has called us to do as we are counterculture, we have to begin to think about the generational curses that we have, and we have to begin to proclaim that, you know what, it stops and ends with me today. You know, we serve a God who thinks generationally. What do you mean, Pastor Ryan? Well, we serve a God that he wants us to know is not all about you. Much of what God is doing in your life today is more about who's coming after you than it is about you specifically. See, God is doing something in your life right now, but it's not only just for you, but it's for those who will come before you, come after you. And I just believe that it was fitting to really dedicate the algo today, because it's so important that we begin to raise up our children in such a way that they begin to fear the Lord. And because we know that God thinks generationally, we have to really go back to the book of Genesis to really proclaim what he's talking about. And so if you don't agree with me that when I say that God thinks generationally, then what I'm saying is that God is thinking beyond just this generation. We see it both in the Old Testament and the New Testament. In Genesis chapter 10, verses 1 through 32, it says that now these are the records of the generations of Shem and Ham and Japheth and the son of Noah, and the sons were born them after the flood. And if we wanted to go back into the New Testament, we can look at the Matthew chapter 1, and it just gives you the recording genealogy of Jesus Christ, our Savior. It talks about Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob, and Jacob, and it goes on and on and on. We see it all throughout the Bible, that our God thinks generationally. So if our God thinks generationally, you and I, we should think generationally as well. So when we talk about being counterculture in today's society, how does that play in your family unit? How does that play within the language that you live out every single day? Well, you know what? Sometimes I just get tired of being a Christian. Can I just be real with you? Like, I miss the enjoyment of just doing life, but you know what? It's just like, I just, being a Christian all the time, sometimes it's just, you know, it's too much work, right? Man, it's thank you. Being a Christian, sometimes it's hard, it's difficult. You know, to kind of walk the straight and narrow, as we would want to call it, right? It's the days where you want to just like, you know what, just, I want to turn in my keys, and I want to turn everything in. I'm like, you know what, I'm just going to flip the script. I'm just going to go back to my old ways and just the way I used to be. So if I had to go back to what I was before I became Christ, BC, this is what it would look like for you. And see, back in the day, swagging, licious, whatever you want to call it, fly, dope, bell bottoms, jeans, you know, whatever you want, whatever your silver toes, whatever you was fly back in the day, I just feel like, you know what, I just want to stop doing what everybody else do. I want to go and just have fun, party all the time, just do what I want to do and just, you know, trying to be a role model for my children. Like, I'm tired of them. Them jokers, they just don't get it. Having kids sometimes, the kids just don't get it. I'm tired of being a role model for them. I'm like, I am done. So I just made a decision, like, you know what? It's all about me now. I'm living my life for me. I want to look like everybody else. I want to talk like everybody else. I want to dress like everybody else. It doesn't matter what you wear on. I just want to do me. You know what? Not only do I want to do that, sometimes coming home from work, wife is fussing at you, got the work to do. Sometimes you just want to just go back to the good old-fashioned, you know. That's some good stuff right there. Hold on. See, back in the day, we had to keep it in a brown bag. Strong. Haven't had that in a while. Keeping it in a brown bag so that way it's kind of concealed. Not only am I just going to turn up every day and just do what I want to do because I'm all about my life right now. You know, there's some things that God placed on this earth that's for medicinal purposes, right? You know, you grow it, and so I figured that, you know, everybody's doing it. Let me just go ahead and let me cut it down the middle, open it up, and do what you know, do just to kind of take the joint pain out. Because sometimes I, you know, getting older, got a little arthritis coming in the knee and everything. So I'm just gonna, you know, be like everybody else. That's how we do it, right? Is it like that? But, you know, I figured, you know, I'm tired of just living this life because this is so much more fun just to go back into the day where I used to be. And I figured, you know, it's okay for me to date multiple people now. You know, I'm a husband of one wife. I used to be a husband of one wife. And I figured my wife and I, now she's my lady. She's my side piece. You know, she's my second chick, you know, my side chick. And so we have this agreement now that we can date anybody that we want. So I want you to meet my wife who's banging. Come on out, babe. Okay. Song says, all the single ladies, all the single ladies, basically it's talking about a lady who's telling her man that he should put a ring on it. But we live in a society today where it's okay for us to kind of cohabitate and not have commitment. See, we want the cookies and the cake, but we don't want the commitment. We tell our kids that it's okay to date and do everything else that's the benefits of a marriage, but not really own up into that marriage. And not only just the fact that we can begin to settle for anything, because let's be truthful. Sometimes what happens is that sometimes we just settle. We settle for whatever we're okay to get. She will minimize herself to say that she has someone to come home to. She will minimize her values. Sometimes we will talk to her any way that we want to. We will do anything that we want to. It's okay for us to step out on each other as we want to. There's certain celebrity relationships that says it's okay to have more than one wife. But this is the generation that we are living in. This is the culture that we are living in. But let me tell you, there is nothing better to know that you are blessed with the covenant of being married. But you know, because we have children, it's only reasonable that we raise our kids the same way that we're doing our life. Partying, doing what we want to do. And so I want you guys to meet my daughters. Oh,
can align. Stand up the road.
All right, that's good.
I see headlights.
This song is by Darius Rucker, and it's called Wagon Wheel. The song says, rock me mama like a wagon wheel, something, 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 something. So what the song is implying is that our girls is okay to be in a relationship with a man in such a way that it's rock me mama like a wagon wheel. I'll let you guys fill in the blanks. If not, see me after church. See, what happens is this. Because of our relationship, my relationship with the mother trickles down to the daughter. And everything that I do to her, they are witnessing. The way that I talk to her, the way that I uphold her, the way that I disrespect her, the way that I even affirm her. They are inheriting that from this relationship. So basically, what you see is what you get. But you know, no family unit wouldn't be perfect, especially for a man, without a male seed to carry on that strong last name, Sims. Come on, church, yes. So this is what we're going to do. I'm going to bring out my boys.
Soldier Boy, I tell you. Hey, I got this new dance for y'all called the Soldier Boy. Just got a bunch of good crank back three times from left to right.
This. They know the words of every song, but they don't know scripture. Come on, church. They know the words of every hip-hop song, every country song, but they don't know scripture. Hip-hop and country is not going to save them. Only the scripture that's in this text will give them revealed truth, revelation about who they are and where they should be and how they should be living their life accordingly. It's not about how many likes they have on Instagram. It's not how many snaps they have. It's none of that. And so when we're talking about generational, we're talking about second generation and birthing third and fourth generation. We have to be careful the model that we are setting up for our kids. So before we go, one church, we're going to take a picture of the one church family. Come on, y'all. Let's get together, take a picture real quick. Y'all ready? Christina, take our picture. That's it. Give it up, give it up. All right. Thank you, guys. Give me a clap. I'll let you know, I'm not drinking at all. Pray for me, brother. The Apostle Paul wrote in Romans chapter 12, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. It says, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then alone will you be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. It says, I urge you, brothers and sisters, that you offer your body as a living sacrifice, pleasing unto God. Do not conform to the pattern of this world. If you were to define present in the Greek, it says to put on display. So that means everything that you do, the music that you listen to, the clothes that you wear, the thoughts, your attitudes, your mindset. This is what Paul is talking about. Put on display. Put on everything that you're doing on display. Those conversations, those DMs, youth and young adults, and maybe some of our older adults. Those private DMs or those messages that you are getting and sending back and forth. Does it really honor God in such a way that it would, if God were to take your cell phone and look through your DMs, what would God say? I'm coming for you now. Would it honor Christ? See, what you meditate will manifest. I want you to get that. What you meditate on will manifest. What do you mean, Pastor Ryan? You reproduce what you replicate. What you meditate on will begin to manifest, and what you reproduce is what you replicate. The things that you begin to mirror, the things that you begin to image and embody yourself in, that is what will be beginning to manifest in and through what you're doing day in and day out. So in case this, since we're talking about generationally, since we're saying that what I'm doing as a father is going to replicate down to my son and my son's son's sons and my kids. So when I think about counterculture and generational curses, divorce, racial inequality, mental health, gang violence, gender equality, immigration, depression, racism, pornography, drug abuse, slave labor, poverty. How do we begin to break the generational curses that's on our families? How do we begin to break down those things that God wants us to pull away from and begin to set your family apart from everything else? See, family is so important because our family unit, we get our culture, our values, our morals, our principles, our authority. We get all of that from our family unit. The way that you're raising and talking with your family, those are the things that we're deriving our families from. See, we learn how to respond to stress, disappointment, even loss, even from our families. You know, when you get angry, you punch walls. When you're sad, do you cry? When you're happy, do you laugh? How do you respond? These are all the different traits that you're learning from your family unit. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 would be our whole scripture for today. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 says this. I'm going to read verse 1 and 2 as well. Now I, Paul, appeal to you with the gentleness and kindness of Christ, though I realize you think I am a timid in person and bold only when I write from far away. Well, I am begging you now so that when I come, I won't have to be bold on those who think to act from human motives. Verse 3, we are humans, but we don't wage war against as humans do. We use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. And after you have become fully obedient, we will punish everyone who remains disobedient. It says this, verse 3, we are human, but we don't wage war as humans do. We use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human. Strongholds, generational curses, those two are linked together. Strongholds and generational curses are linked together. See, the devil wants to destroy the life, and with the curses, he establishes a stronghold which becomes a dwelling place for him. I want you to get that. See, our generational curses is a gateway for strongholds to sit and reside, because he wants to break down who you are and allow those strongholds to reside into where you're at. See, so many of us are dealing with things from our past that is affecting our present, which ultimately will affect your future. So what does it say, generational curses in the scripture? I'm going to give you three versions of it. Exodus chapter 20, verses 2 through 5. It says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt and out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an image from anything in heaven above or on earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am jealous. I'm a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of their parents to the third and fourth generation. Let me read that one more time. It says, because of the sins of the parents, that I will punish the third and fourth generation. I want you to take an inventory real quick. Take an inventory of some things that you've been struggling with. Take an inventory of some things that you and your family has been struggling for years, maybe decades. Because scripture says right here that because of the sins of our parents, we are being punished to the fourth, even the third generation. So I had to go back in just time to take inventory. Begin to think about, what are some things that I'm dealing with? What are some things that I'm dealing with as a parent that I don't want to transfer over to my kids? Before I go there, let me give you Exodus 34 and 7. It says this: maintain the love to thousands and forgiving weakness, rebelling and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. Again, he says, he punishes the children and the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. Same thing, Numbers 14 and 8 says the exact same thing. Parents, we are being punished for our parents' wickedness to the third and fourth generation. I want us to remind ourselves today, take a mental note. What are the things that you're dealing with? What are the things that your kids are dealing with? Is it because of your great-great-great-grandfather or your great-great-great-grandmother? I begin to ask God, how do we begin to really break the chains of generational curses and strongholds? Let me give you three ways. Because identifying them may be somewhat easy. For some, it may not be easy for all of us. But the how-to begin to address it is where I really want to kind of land this plane today. Because I know that we can always go back and say, this is why I'm dealing with this, or this is why I'm dealing with that. And it's because of this. The how is this: you must fully surrender your life to Christ. That's the first prerequisite. You have to fully surrender your life to Christ. James chapter 4, verse 7 says this: submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts. See, submitting to God means that you have to enter into a complete and full surrender. It's a posture. They're saying, God, I'm giving up. I can't win. I can't do this on my own. I need you to come into my life. I need you to come and save me. So you have to begin to identify those areas in your life. Identification precedes transformation. If you can't identify what's going on in your life, then God can't transform it. God wants you to confess those very things that you've been dealing with, those things that you've been dealing with from week after week, year after year. Maybe for decades. Growing up as a young boy, I always wondered, like, man, why are we in this situation that we are, that, you know, that we're living in? My mom, single mom, raised four kids. You know, my dad left us. He left a mother with four kids. I think we were three. My older sister was probably seven. The oldest was probably 12. left her with a house, a car, and two jobs. I can remember my mom walking to work, literally in the snow. We lived in upstate New York called Rochester. You guys know anything about that area? Rochester, Buffalo area, nothing but snow. Car broke down. She would literally get up early in the morning to go to work so she could provide. I remember watching my mom not eat for days so that way we can have something to eat. Sometimes a meal was a lettuce sandwich. No meat, no mayonnaise. We couldn't afford mayonnaise. Just bread and lettuce. Then people would ask me, Ryan, why do you work so hard? Because I'm trying to break a generational curse. Why do you do so much for your kids? Because I'm pressing after that generational curse. Why do you live the life that you live? Because that curse stops with my family right now and today. Being the father that I need to be to my kids and being the husband I need to be to my wife stops with me. Fully surrendering myself to God, even when it's the hardest, even when I have the temptation to go back to what I used to do back in the day. Let's be real. May not be for you, but I mean, we all have that temptation. Like, just for one day, God, can I just go back and just kind of enjoy? But you know what? To be honest, church, I have more fun being a Christian than I did being in the world. Like, for real. Like, I enjoy being a Christian 10 times more than I used to be without being in the world. And things that we do for our kids, the things that we do for our church, the things that we display before everyone, because you want people to know that being a Christian, a ride or die, sold out, living life for God, chasing Him, seeking His presence day after day, is a greater reward than it would be chasing everything else. God told me, Ryan, quit chasing money, chase Him. Guys, I was chasing corporate ladder like I was, because I grew up poor. I told myself I would not allow a non-name brand box of cereal enter into my house. Because back in the day, the cornflakes we used to eat used to be in a black and white box. You have to sprinkle sugar over it. So y'all don't know about that. Cheerios. Completely surrendering all that I am to God. And guys, that comes with a cost. See, if you only don't read the entire scripture, I read Exodus chapter 20, verse 5, and that's where the scripture says that if you take on the sins of your parents to the third and fourth generation, but if you read verse 6, there's some glory in verse 6. That's why you have to read the full text of the scriptures. Verse 6 says this, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. See, if we just stop at verse 5, then we can say, woe is me. But if you continue on in the reading of the scriptures, you get to see what the blessing that will become before you if you walk this walk. It says that showing love to 1,000 generations to those who love me and keep my commandments. That far outweighs verse 5. Point number 2. Fully confess. Fully confess. What I mean, fully confess the sins of your sinning parents to God the Father. That means you have to really call out the things that your parents did and confess them so that way God can deal with them. Leviticus 26 and 41 says this. Leviticus chapter 26 and 41. But if they confess their iniquities and the iniquities of their fathers, and their treachery that they committed against me, and also in walking contrary to me, so that I walk contrary to them and brought them into a land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised heart is humbled and they make amends of their iniquity. Verse 42 says this, then I will remember my covenant with Jacob, and I will remember my covenant with Isaac, and my covenant with Abraham, and I will remember their land. What God is saying, if you just call out the sins of your parents, he will remember that covenant, that promise that he gave Isaac and Jacob. What he's saying is that I will go back into the days when I spoke the existence of this earth, when I made you and formed you out of the dirt. He said that I will remember that covenant that I gave you. And that covenant is a blessing. The blessing that comes with walking with Christ. And what God wants us to do is that he wants us to confess the sins of our fathers. So guys, part of our sermon series is a lot of this stuff that we dealt up here. And as you already can kind of tell, I wasn't raised by my father. My father left us. And my relationship with him wasn't the best. It wasn't about. About 15 years ago, my wife and I was doing a family retreat. And we had this idea, like, let's invite our dads to this family retreat. Because neither one of us had a relationship with our dad. And so we sat our fathers down and we just told them, said, look, we forgive you for walking out on our mothers. We forgive you for being absent in our lives. We forgive you for the exposure of the things that you've done in our lives as well. Being super transparent. My father was the one who exposed me to pornography. Exposing me to such filth at a young age. Distorts what marriage looks like. It distorts what a relationship looks like. And I told my dad, I said, Dad, I love you. But I got to tell you, I forgive you as well. And it wasn't until then that my relationship with my father began to be restored. Because he needed to know that he was forgiven by me. Not that it's required, but he needed that point where I just told him, I forgive him. And so me confessing the things that was generationally being exposed to me from my father, the things that I acquired from both my mother and my father, I've been to cry out to God and say, God, this is what I'm dealing with. And God, it has to stop with me. And so when we talk about being married 5 and 6 and 7 times, we used to joke every time we went to a family reunion at my house on my dad's side, like, who we get to meet this time? Like, is it going to be another brother, another sister? Because every family reunion that we had with my dad, this is your brother. I'm like, I'm doing the math. So I have a twin brother and 2 sisters, but I have 1, 2, 3, you know, all these other siblings about our same age. I do the math. That doesn't add up. We have to begin to fully confess the sins of our parents to the Lord, our Father. And if you have the opportunity to confess the sins of your parents, talk with them. And last but not least, fully forgive. Fully forgive them. You have to forgive fully the sins of your parents. Mark 11:25 says this. And whenever you stand up praying, if anything against anyone, forgive him, that your Father in heaven may also forgive you of your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you. So when we talk about generational curses and strongholds, I just really was just touching on this briefly. Because there's really no way that we can do this one sermon just in one Sunday. To really go into generational curses and strongholds, that's 6 or 7 weeks is just this presentation. But what I wanted to do today is this, just to bring an awareness about what that can do for you and through you. So as our worship team prepares today, to my left and to your right, we have a cross right here. And at the footstool of the cross, we have two hammers and we have some nails. And some of the nails, I think most of the nails has a red ribbon on it. We're going to sing Break Every Chain. And what I want you to do, if you have the desire, is to grab a nail and hammer that nail to the cross. Because I want you to break the chains of your generational curses that you may not even know that you're up under right now. If you don't do it for yourself, do it for a family member. Do it for somebody that you're connected to. Because we all have some generational curses and some strongholds that we are walking in that God is just navigating through our lives. Take it. Call it out as you're hammering into the cross. It's because of the cross that he died for us. He died for those sins. I want you guys to have the opportunity to break the chains of counterculture. And as we go throughout this series, it's just going to get deeper and deeper. And it's going to get harder and harder. If you want somebody to pray with you today, come to the altar. We will pray with you. We will anoint you if you want to have the oil. We want to touch and agree to see what God can do in and through you. Let us stand.